math seminar for the academic year. And today's speaker is Madhur Tulsiani. He's going to talk to us about Goldreich-Levin theorems for quadratic functions.
Okay, so I'll use a few notions from Fourier analysis in the talk, so let me just define them before we start, and then I can mention more about the results and the subject of the talk. So first, this notation, we'll only be concerned with functions from f2 to the n to functions which are real valued. Okay. Whatever I will say can be made to work over fp to the n for any small p, or so the constants in the will have a dependence on p, but I'll only talk of f2 in this entire talk. And certain if you want to do Fourier analysis, certain special functions are important, which are functions which I denote by chi sub alpha of x, which is nothing but minus 1 to the power of a linear function. So I just take the inner product of alpha and x, where alpha and x are both vectors in f2 to the n. So this is just a bit, and it's just a plus or minus one valued function. These functions form an orthonormal basis for this space, and you can write any function f as a linear combination of these functions. The coefficient is what is called the Fourier coefficient, and these are called Fourier characters. And it's just because it's a basis, you just want to look at the inner product of f with this function chi sub alpha to get the coefficient, and this inner product is defined as expectation of the product of two functions, which is also something I'll call correlation between the two functions. Okay. Unless otherwise mentioned, all expectations will be over x uniformly drawn in f2 to the n. And one, because we just expressed f in some different basis, it doesn't change the L2 norm of it, and this is called the Parseval identity or Parseval-Plancherel identity. It just says that if you look at the L2 norm of f square in the usual way that you look at expectation of f square, or if you look at it by in the Fourier basis where you add up sum of squares of the Fourier coefficients, it's the same norm. Okay. So just some very basic stuff. Another notion which I'll need is what are called Gowers norms, and they will sort of play a role in the results. Okay. So these were defined by Tim Gowers in his study of arithmetic progressions in primes, and they sort of help extend Fourier analysis as described here to somewhat more general settings, which is what is called the theory of quadratic Fourier analysis, and that will be the subject of the talk. But let me just define these norms. So for a function, we'll define its U2 norm, and I'll actually write it as the fourth power or the 2 to the 2 power, just suggestively, as the average of the function over two-dimensional boxes or two-dimensional parallelepipeds for which the endpoints are x, x plus y, x plus z, x plus y plus z. And just think of it as a box. So I just multiply the values of f over endpoints of this box, and this is the fourth power of the U2 norm, just because you want to grow linearly with scaling. And via some manipulations, you can actually show that this is just the sum of the fourth powers of the Fourier coefficients for the U2 norm. And so from what I wrote here, you can take out the maximum Fourier coefficient, a second power of it, a square of it. So you get the maximum Fourier coefficient, alpha star is the alpha which maximizes the Fourier coefficient, times the sum of squares, which is the norm square, as I mentioned. And this is an upper bound on the fourth power of the U2 norm, which is in turn an upper bound on the fourth power of the largest Fourier coefficient. So U2 norm sort of measures the largest Fourier coefficient if the L2 norm of the function is bounded. Let's say this is 1, and that will be the case for most functions we consider. So then it's within a quadratic factor of the largest Fourier coefficient of the function. Okay. What we'll talk more about, and I'll discuss much more about this later, is the U3 norm of Gowers, which is just, again, the average of the function over three-dimensional boxes for which the endpoints are x, x plus y, x plus z, x plus w, and so on. And this is the eighth power, or the 2 to the 3rd power. And so you can guess how you can one defines a UK norm for a general K. I won't need it, and so I won't write it down explicitly. Again, all functions are real valued. There is no conjugations anywhere. The definition for general functions involves conjugations alternately on these, but everything is real valued in this talk. Okay, so let's start with very basic theorems in Fourier analysis. So let's just rewrite that Fourier decomposition of a function f that I have there. So let's write it. And so just for kicks, I'll call it g this time. So the classical Fourier analysis says that given a function g, you can decompose it in the following way. And this is something I already wrote. And I can further split this summation in two ways. I mean, this is just the absolute value of this coefficient.
Yeah, no, just
The bound? It's epsilon.
It's epsilon, I see.
Okay. So this is just trivial. But this decomposition actually is interesting to know in several respects, because you see, this part tells you all the information you need about the Fourier coefficients which are important, for which the coefficients are large. And this part, if you are just interested in how your function looks with respect to these functions chi alpha or these Fourier characters, it has small correlation with every single one of them. This summation has small correlation with every single character chi alpha, right? Because they're orthogonal. So in general, you write this as the first sum . So I decompose my function into some part which captures all the large Fourier coefficients and some part which has all Fourier coefficients small or does not correlate well with any Fourier coefficient. And this is so the very basic decomposition in classic Fourier analysis. And this part has a nice structure, because remember, the sum of the squares of a Fourier coefficient is the L2 norm of the function. And this function just has a projection of function g, because the character chi alphas are orthogonal, I just projected it along some of them. So the L2 norm of this is at most the L2 norm of g. And let's suppose, and it will always be the case, that whenever I write g, it will be a function which is bounded between minus 1 and 1. So the L2 norm in particular is at most 1. So there are at most 1 over epsilon square terms in this summation, because sum of squares of the coefficients is 1. So I get a decomposition of my function into something which has a simple structure. And something which is, let's say, pseudorandom, in the sense that if you look how this function f looks to these characters, it has small correlation. And that's what is true for a random function. It has small correlation with any character. So it sort of looks random to at least these character functions. Okay, and this decomposition is sort of a starting point if you want to apply Fourier analysis for many applications in number theory. And of course, if you are a computer scientist, one obvious question is, okay, it's a very nice description. Can I actually compute it? So can I actually compute this list or this sum? And then the rest will be f, of course. So I just want to know that. And this can be done. And this is a theorem of Goldreich and Levin, which is what we'll build on. So there is an algorithm A which, given parameters, let's say delta and epsilon bigger than 0, and oracle access to G by oracle access, I just mean that if the algorithm wants to query g of x at any x, there is some procedure which will return it to it. It doesn't have the entire g as input because it's too long, and we want the running time to be polynomial in n, not in the length of this input. And it runs in time polynomial in n, 1 over epsilon and log 1 over delta. And outputs a decomposition. It gives us, it says G is equal to summation over some coefficients Ci, chi of alpha I, plus the remaining part F. Okay. So it actually computes this. And what is the guarantee? So when it outputs this, it holds with probability 1 minus delta that, I mean, I'll just put probability 1 minus delta for all of it, except maybe just some conclusions need to hold with probability 1 minus delta. The others always hold, but let's just say it this way. So the number of terms in this summation is small. The CIs are very close to the actual Fourier coefficients. So it even, this is a stronger property. It actually estimates them very correctly. So such that okay. And the third property is that every Fourier coefficient which is important is inside this list, or sort of every large Fourier coefficient is here. It doesn't miss out anything. So because it's an orthogonal decomposition, I can just, if it missed out some Fourier coefficient, that will be present here. So I can just say that there exists alpha such that greater than or equal to epsilon, the probability of this thing is less than or equal to delta.
So this is the same delta in the probability that you get it and the probability that these events?
Let's say. I mean, you can change them, but I'll just use the same delta. Okay. So, and this running time is not horrible. It's like n square log n. So
what you have already said, that with probability 1 minus delta, this whole thing
happens. Oh, I see.
So, for all I mean, this is small, right?
Never mind.
Probability 1.
Sure. Okay. So this is the classical Goldreich-Levin theorem for Fourier analysis. Now what I want to do is describe to you the notion of quadratic Fourier analysis and essentially ask the same question. If I can compute the natural decompositions that come up in quadratic Fourier analysis, which are developed in recent years. Okay. So let's go there. Okay. So the basic functions in quadratic Fourier analysis that we'll be interested are what are called quadratic functions. So if you think about this, this alpha transpose x is just a linear function of x. And in quadratic Fourier analysis, as you would expect, you look at quadratic functions of f. So I will call q of x, some quadratic function, will be of the form, so in the exponent, I have some x transpose mx, which is a quadratic form, plus some linear part. So maybe I'll call it b transpose x plus some constant. So a quadratic function, which I'll denote by little q, will be of this form. Okay. And so the basic decomposition theorem, which you can now, the interesting thing is, in usual Fourier analysis, we knew that the linear functions were orthogonal, and so you could do the decomposition very nicely simply by using orthogonality in a vector space. This is not true for the quadratic functions. In particular, the space of functions is has dimension 2 to the n, and the number of quadratic functions is 2 to the order n square. So you can't, they are not orthogonal, they don't form a basis or anything, but you still want a decomposition. And here's what you actually can get. So this was made explicit in the work of Gowers and Wolf, and also in a sort of exposition of Gowers on a proof technique which uses the Hahn-Banach theorem or convex duality, essentially. This was, I think the papers were around since 2008. These are just in the time when they were published in journals. So this might be 2010 or 9, depending on when it was around. Let's just say this. And it says this, that if you have a function g, again of this form, let's say, there are three terms now in this decomposition. This is what you would expect. It's just sum of some coefficients times quadratic functions. So QIs are quadratic phases, what they are called, like the one written there. So okay, actually, to be able to define this, I'll need to state the usual decomposition in terms of Gowers norms. So notice that here we said that every Fourier coefficient of f is small, is less than epsilon. But here we have a relation between the U2 norm of f and the largest Fourier coefficient of f. The L2 norm of f is one, again at most 1. So if this is less than epsilon, the Gowers norm is at most root epsilon. So this is the same as saying that not the same, but it's implied by saying that the U2 norm of f is less than root epsilon.
For Boolean functions, it is the same.
I'm sorry?
For Boolean functions, this would be the same. Like if f had plus minus 1 output.
I mean, no, not the same, because I extracted out the maximum. It's an upper bound.
The lower bound is not, the upper bound is not tight.
Oh, that's all I want.
I
mean, yeah, it's not very different. Epsilon will be losing so much in epsilon in the next few minutes that this root epsilon won't matter.
Oh, okay.
So let me just miss it. But in particular, so for example, if you want the Gowers norm to be less than epsilon, this means that the number of terms here is 1 over epsilon to the 4, if I just want to repeat. So it's some polynomial in epsilon. That's not true. And here, turns out the right quantity to bound is, as you might have guessed, the U3 norm of f. So we get the property is that the U3 norm of f is bounded. Also, the L1 norm of E is bounded. So the third term is actually bounded in the L1 norm. Let's say epsilon again. What does which mean? This part?
This should imply what is above.
No, it
doesn't. So it's the other,
it
doesn't.
Oh, you want it to be?
Should it be epsilon?
No.
This should not imply that part, right? I can get this decomposition. In particular, this decomposition satisfies this. So this implies this. Right? So this is what I get, and I can just rewrite what I get as a different guarantee, a slightly weaker guarantee, which is this. So this guarantee, which I know how to get, implies this guarantee. So I also know how to get this one. That's all I'm saying.
So you've changed the notions of the parameters so that it's epsilon instead of epsilon to the
No, so the correlation with quadratics and how the Gowers U3 norm relate is very bad.
Oh.
And that I'll mention in a minute. Oh. So that's why I just want to talk of Gowers U3 norm right now, and then I'll get to how they correlate with the.
You could have stated this also with, or at least it's reasonable to ask this thing even with.
Correlation with quadratics. Exactly, I'll come to that. So what I'll prove will also give you that. And so that's how the intuition for it, proving it is. And we'll see. So we'll play around with this epsilon. The problem is that, it's somewhat unavoidable unless we resolve some conjectures in additive number theory, that k is the only bound on k you can get is some number m of epsilon, which is something of the form which is exponential in 1 over epsilon to some constant. If I have a prime field Fp, this constant will depend on p, but otherwise we'll get this. E wasn't there before, and we'll see why it comes up in the decomposition. So I'll actually prove this decomposition, and I'll show you why E comes up. I'll give you a different proof than the one Gowers and Wolf had, which uses Hahn-Banach or linear programming or convex duality. That's hard to turn into an algorithm. I'll give you a slightly different proof which can be turned into one, and we'll see why we need E there. Okay, so the result, the basic result is what you would expect, that we can compute essentially this decomposition, something that satisfies this property. I'll state it formally in a minute, but let's see how we try to prove such a decomposition theorem. If you have any questions about the specifics of what it is, please feel free to ask. Okay, so can I erase Goldreich-Levin?
Okay,
I can erase maybe this Goldreich-Levin. I'll probably use this one later. Okay, so let's try to prove a decomposition theorem in a way that is completely general, doesn't have anything to do with quadratic phases or some special kind of functions. And this is an argument which was, the basic argument is due to Fries and Kannan, where they were actually decomposing graphs into some simpler structures. And the general argument was worked out in a paper of Luca Trevisan and Salil Vadan and myself. So this is an argument, so in the general decomposition theorems. And the arguments follow Fries-Kannan and some other recent work. So now suppose we actually go as Swastik suggested, that instead of saying that the U3 norm of F is bounded, let's try to see if we can get the correlation of F with every quadratic function to be small, with every quadratic phase. So what we want to do now is, we have a class of functions, which I suggestively call script Q. And I have G, which is a function as before. And I want to decompose G as some combination of functions from script Q plus some F. Such that, so I'll actually try to get, so in general I can get very good bounds here. This k will be less than 1 over epsilon square. And I'll get that uh, the absolute value of the correlation is small. Okay. Doesn't correlate. And actually, let's just assume that QIs are Boolean. And also, if I have a function Q in my class, then I also have the negation of Q in my class. So that allows me to remove this absolute value because I can always plug in the negation. Okay. So this is a very good decomposition theorem. The number of terms is bounded very well. And the correlation with quadratics is small, which is also, as we thought, is an OK notion. It's not bad. Boolean means plus 1, minus 1. And this proof actually comes with an algorithm, or sort of an algorithm. It's not quite one. So it just says, let's start building up this summation in the first, which is the first term of the decomposition. So let's start with, at time 1, let's start with the summation to as 0. And let's start with the function f at time 1 to be whatever remains after subtracting the summation. So this is a starting decomposition. And then we say, if this is not good, so there exists so the okay. So this is the algorithm. Okay. And the way I defined it, obviously, when the algorithm stops, if it does at all, the f, that little output, will have a small correlation because it will get out of this loop. So all I need to tell you is that the algorithm stops, and moreover, it stops in less than 1 over epsilon squared steps. Okay. And the proof is actually literally just 2 lines. So I measure, so to measure the progress of this function, I construct a potential function, which is just the L2 norm of this function f. So I look at L2 norm of Ft square, and I see how it changes with time. And I show you that this decreases by at least epsilon square at every step, which means the L2 norm of the starting function, which was just g itself, was at most 1. So it can only decrease 1 over epsilon square times. And this is not too difficult. So the first term is just the inner product of Ft with itself. The second, Ft plus 1 is just Ft, let's see, plus or minus? Minus. Minus epsilon times Q sub t. Right? This is the only extra term that appeared in the summation. So bunch of things cancel. This is equal to 2 epsilon times the inner product of Q sub t times F sub t minus epsilon square. Oh, epsilon square times the inner product of Q sub t with itself. The Qs are Boolean, so this is less than or equal to 1. And this, by assumption, is bigger than or equal to epsilon. Oh, it's the Boolean, it's exactly 1, sure. So yeah, OK, then it also tells you this works in general when you have functions which are bounded between minus 1 and 1. And as you see, this argument did not use anything about how the Qs looked. It gives you a decomposition, which is perfectly good. The number of terms is 1 over epsilon square and so on. The catch is this step. So it's almost an algorithm in which I build up this decomposition, except that every step I need to find this Q sub t. And if I could find this, then I'd be done. So in particular, this asks the question of, if I know that f sub t has correlation epsilon with a quadratic phase, can I find a quadratic phase like that? This problem was the problem of testing. So the problem of just checking the condition in the while loop here, does it have correlation epsilon with some quadratic phase, was actually studied by Samorodnitsky. And the test is slightly lossy in the sense, if there is a correlation, if the algorithm answers yes, if Samorodnitsky's test answers yes, then you know, you check for epsilon, but the correlation, if it answers yes, the correlation is at least some function of epsilon, which is positive if epsilon is positive, but can be very, very small. And so what you actually know how to do is sort of an approximate test. You have a test. If the test answers yes, in which case you'll go into the loop, you know that the correlation is at least some eta of epsilon, where eta is greater than 0 if epsilon greater than 0. But eta is actually fairly small. It's again this dependence of exponentially small and epsilon to some constant, right? So that's what Samorodnitsky's test gives you.
The test gives you whether there exists a quadratic function or gives you the quadratic function?
No, it doesn't give you the quadratic function, and that's what the rest of the talk is about. It tells you if there exists a quadratic function. But even there, I want to emphasize that there is this loss between epsilon and eta, which is why you have to change this algorithm a little bit, and that's where the term E arises. Okay, so let's see if we can modify this algorithm to work with it. Okay, so I guess I'll erase this part now. Or the preliminaries are okay with almost everybody, I guess. I allow for a larger list. I actually don't know how to get any list without looking at that E. Any list of, like any bound on the size of the list, I don't know how to get it without the E.
So if you have the Q sub T, why couldn't you just put in eta instead of epsilon on the definition of ST plus 1?
Exactly, that's what I propose to do, but we'll see where the problem occurs. So as Paul suggested, we could, sure, I test for epsilon. So if the algorithm says no, means the correlation is less than epsilon. If Samorodnitsky's test says no, means the correlation is less than epsilon. If it says yes, means the correlation is more than eta. There is a loss between epsilon and eta. Okay, so suppose it says yes, I surely know that there is the correlation is more than eta, so I can replace this by eta, right? And I can run with this algorithm. Again, in this analysis, I will have etas instead of epsilons. And everything will work out. Well, except for the fact that Samorodnitsky's test works only if the function for which you are testing correlation with the quadratic is bounded in L infinity norm, or sort of is bounded between minus 1 and 1. And this is not true for the functions we are looking at, because g is a function which is bounded. We are subtracting off some summation of many functions from it, many Boolean functions. And the number of terms, each term is weighted by eta, but the number of terms can be 1 over, or weighted by epsilon, the number of terms could be 1 over epsilon square. So the L infinity norm could get large. And it's sort of, the way the guarantees are given for Samorodnitsky's test, you can't trivially scale it, and that's the problem where you need E. Let's I'm sorry. Oh, sorry.
Madhur, do you know that you need E, or just your analysis steps?
My analysis does, and also does the analysis of Gowers and Wolf, who prove it using Hahn-Banach. So I don't know of a proof, but I haven't computed a counterexample or something.
So why couldn't you, for an existential proof, why can't you use this thing here?
Sorry?
Why can't you use the machinery you did with Madhur Tulsiani to get an existential proof?
Oh, sure, I do get it. But this existential proof is for correlation with quadratics. So when I just want to say that F has small correlation with every quadratic, I get a decomposition with 1 over epsilon square terms and no E term. If I want a decomposition like Gowers and Wolf have, where the guarantee is on the Gowers norm of F, then you need E. Because essentially the loss of epsilon versus eta that happens in Samorodnitsky's test is because you don't have a good relation between Gowers norm, U3 norm, and the correlation with quadratics. So what you do know is that if there exists a quadratic Q such that the correlation of F with Q is bigger than epsilon, and let's suppose F is bounded in L2 norm for now, or bounded in L infinity even. So let's say that F, so this holds for, then the Gowers norm is bigger, is large. And what was proved by Samorodnitsky is what is called the inverse theorem for Gowers norm. Is that if the Gowers norm is large, so and the test is essentially this. The Gowers norm of a function is just some average of function over three-dimensional boxes. You can estimate it very well by sampling the value of F on a lot of three-dimensional boxes, because it's just the average, and you want to just estimate the mean, which can be done very well by sampling. So that's the test. You estimate this guy. If it's larger than 3 epsilon over 2, you say yes. Otherwise, you say no. And if it's the estimate is larger than 3 epsilon over 2, then with very high probability, the actual quantity is larger than epsilon. And by this theorem, you know that there is a quadratic function whose correlation is at least eta. So, but because of this problem, this loss of epsilon versus eta also happens, even if I want to prove an existential theorem, where I want a guarantee on the U3 norm instead of correlation with quadratics. So even in the existential theorem, I need an E term there. And I mean, I'll explain why this loss requires an E term, or at least in the proof, it needs an E term.
And this correlation here only works if the L infinity norm is small too, so you need E.
Yeah, so this is when the correlation works. And let's see what happens if I want to work with functions which have large L infinity norm. Okay, so the plan is that in the next 10 minutes, I just want to explain to you why, how do you handle this L infinity norm problem. In the next 1 hour, we'll talk to you about Samorodnitsky's test and what goes in there. Okay, so now suppose I have a function F such that the L infinity norm of F equals some number k. So the obvious way to fit it in that framework is scaling F. So if I know that the Gowers norm of F is large, then I know that the Gowers norm of F, which is scaled by k, is bigger than epsilon over k, which means that there exists Q which satisfies that the correlation of Q with F over K is greater than exponential in minus k over epsilon to some constant, and which in turn implies that correlation of q with f is bigger than k times exponential in minus k over epsilon to some constant. Okay, this is what I know how to conclude. But then you see there is a problem, because the eta degrades as the L infinity norm of f grows. The correlation has a very bad dependence on this. But then as I proceed through my algorithm, the L infinity norm grows, which means the eta degrades and I need to proceed for even more steps. So this is kind of a circular problem, and I don't know how to argue termination of this algorithm with this problem. So this is where the E comes in. What I just do is, so let's write the algorithm here. So let's say I start with S1 equals 0, F1 equals 0, F1 equals G, and E1 equals 0. Okay. And now I want to just keep the L infinity norm of f bounded to be able to apply this test. So I'll just bound it brute force. So I'll just say while instead of let's saying saying there exists q, let's directly say that the Gowers norm of f is large epsilon, which means and I will ensure that the L infinity norm of f is less than equal to some number, some absolute bound b, okay, in the entire algorithm. So then which means that and because so this implies that there exists a quadratic such that the correlation of the quadratic with f is greater than equal to b times exponential in minus b over epsilon to some constant, right? Well, b is an absolute bound, is an invariant that I maintain through the algorithm. Sorry. Okay. So this means that there exists q such that the inner product of f with q is bigger than b times an exponential in b over epsilon to the c. So if I know this, then and let's call this eta. Okay, I guess. So now I do the usual thing that st plus 1 equals st plus eta times q sub t, let's call it. The interesting thing is, how do I maintain the bound? Well, it's actually the most obvious thing you would do. That let's say, let's call e plus f equals h. So h sub t plus 1 is just what would have been f, which is g minus s sub t plus 1. So this is actually e plus f, both the terms here. And I will break up this h just in the obvious way, that f is the truncation of f to have L infinity norm between minus b and b, which means that I look at, for every point, I look at the value of h. If it's bigger than b, I change it to b. If it's less than minus b, I make it minus b. And if it's between those two, I leave it unchanged. So this is just the truncation to the interval minus b, b of h sub t plus 1. and E is the rest. So this is now a decomposition where I just brute force maintained a bound on this norm. The analysis of this algorithm requires a little bit more work and a slightly different potential function. So I'll mention the potential function. I won't give you the full analysis, slightly calculations, but it's the interesting part of the potential function. So it's sort of what you would expect, that you look at Ft square plus 2b times the L1 norm of E. This is the potential function. And I show that this decreases by eta square at every step, where eta is this quantity. Okay. If I can show this, then I would be done, because first of all, if it decreases, we started with F equals G, so L2 norm was 1, and this quantity was 0. E was 0 initially. So we started with this to be the potential as 1, and it decreases. So after 1 over eta square steps, we'll stop. So of course, the number of terms will be bounded. Because it was 1 and always decreased, this term in particular is at most 1 when we stop, which means that the L1 norm is at most 1 over 2 times capital B. So when we stop, the L1 norm is small. And then I can take B to be 1 over epsilon again, so I'll just get 1 over epsilon square to some constant here. And then L1 norm will be less than epsilon over 2, if you want.
Sorry, can you not put a better bound on what the L1 norm would be? Because the whole potential goes down, right? It goes down, the whole potential goes down by at least eta square.
Yeah,
after
but
after t steps, you're at most 1 minus 2 eta square t.
Oh, sure, I can do that. But I don't know how the number of steps,
you don't know how long
the number of steps are. I mean, in any way, sort of this kind of dependence is there because of this dependence between Gowers norm and the correlation with quadratics. And the problem is it's already inside an exponential, sort of some improvements don't really improve the qualitative nature.
And is this connected to be optimal?
No. Well, it's not known, but improving this bound requires what is called the polynomial Ruja, sort of solving the polynomial Ruja conjecture, which is something I'll state, and we'll say at some point we apply the Freeman-Ruja theorem. And this is that theorem is what causes the loss here. And that conjecture is essentially getting rid of, getting a better bound in the Freeman-Ruja theorem. And that would directly imply, but it's sort of equivalent to that problem. So yeah, modulo resolving that conjecture, this is the best bound we know as of now. No, it doesn't actually. So, because, so the relation, I mean, if you notice the dependence between U2 norm, so there was a quadratic loss, but then there was also this L2 norm term in the relation. So, I had the bound which was of the form that sort of, if I'm looking at the maximum Fourier coefficient square times the L2 norm of F, is greater than equal to the 4 is greater than equal to no, not sorry, not this.
So you're saying that as you run the algorithm, you'll always have L infinity at most 1?
No, the L infinity norm will change. Uh-huh. But the problem, the thing is that after I scale, so I can scale it, the function to be between minus 1 and 1. So then both this term and this term will scale by the same quantity. So there will be a power of 4 in the scaling everywhere in this inequality. So I can always find if the Gowers, the 2 norm is bigger than epsilon, I can always find a linear function with which the correlation is bigger than epsilon, no matter what the L infinity norm is.
Okay.
this issue doesn't arise in here. You see the point? Because this quantity and this quantity will both scale by k. And so there'll be a k to the 4 everywhere in the inequality. So yeah, it's slightly funny that it arises here. But as I said, this is a general decomposition to deal with this issue whenever it, and I mean, this is sort of why they need it even in the Hahn-Banach theorem, except it's slightly less obvious because it's not constructive. Okay, so if we have this decomposition theorem, we are down to getting an algorithmic version of Samorodnitsky, which is getting an algorithm for this part of the problem. Yeah, I was just about to break after I just said this.
Okay.
Yeah. So, is it okay to say that to get an algorithm for computing the decomposition, it's sufficient to get an algorithm for finding such a Q in this theorem? Okay, and let's take a 5-minute break and then get from. Before I go there, just one more variant of the result I want to mention. So right now we got a decomposition in terms of this quadratic phases, and we had 1 over eta square terms where eta was very, very small. So the number of terms was exponential. You can get a slightly better decomposition theorem, which is of the following form. And this also, for this theorem, we give an algorithm in the paper, but I won't discuss it today. So you can write g as summation ci, let's call these functions q tilde I, plus e plus f. The same kind of things hold, that the u3 norm of f is less than epsilon, the l1 norm of it's a small. The QIs are slightly different functions. They're not quadratics. But using them, what I can get is that K is less than poly 1 over epsilon. And what the QIs look like are sort of buckets of quadratics. So the QIs are of the following form. I look at a subspace, some subspace V, and I look at cosets of it. And then I look at indicator function of this coset. In every coset, I have a different quadratic phase. So the QIs are sort of averages of quadratic phases. So you can think that I have clubbed a lot of terms in that decomposition together into just poly 1 over epsilon bundles. But here they are nice in the sense that they look like the following. They look of the form, and this, there is another expectation. Over x in this coset. So there is some quadratic phase function q which of x minus y plus some linear term which depends on y. So basically for every qi I have a single q. So the quadratic part in all these phases is essentially the same. They are slightly different in the sense that there is a different linear term for each of them on depending on the coset in which I am. V is a subspace. Of codimension, which is of order poly 1 over epsilon. It's a subspace of F2 to the n. It's x's are coming from that subspace.
You don't need the indicator function.
I do, because for this subspace, I look at this quadratic phase in which this Ly is there.
Right, but you're already averaging over x in the
y plus. Oh, I see. OK, so let's just write it this way. I mean, this is actually true. I mean, it's not the same. In fact, I lost something, but this is true. And so you can actually write a simple sort of decomposition in which the quadratics are very related, a lot of quadratic phases, just by they differ essentially by a linear term in different cosets of the subspace. This was sort of implicit in the green tau proof of the inverse Gowers for Fp. It didn't work for F2, but you can combine some things from Samorodnitsky to get it for F2 as well. And you can get an algorithm for computing these qi tildes instead of qi's. Yeah.
So this is a function of y? What is qi tilde?
Qi tilde is a function of x. Sorry. There is no averaging. And this is a sum over y in v per. Thanks. And this is v. I'm looking at cosets. So basically, I just look at which coset do I lie in. I look at the indicator function of that coset, and I look at the appropriate quadratic phase. Yeah. Sorry about the confusion. So this is just a sum. Notice the number of terms inside the summation itself is exponential in 1 over poly 1 over epsilon. So sort of if you put all of these together, you still get exponentially many terms, except you just group these exponentially many terms into this very nice bundle in which you get the same quadratic part and some different linear parts. As of now, the description part, the description length of this is still long, is exponential in this. And maybe that can be reduced, but we don't know yet. This is, I won't get into more details of this, and let me get back to the algorithm for Samorodnitsky's test. Yeah.
Do we know an algorithmic way to do that?
No, because the only way I know of testing correlation with quadratics is Samorodnitsky's test, where I lose the epsilon to eta anyway. So I know there exists, but I don't know how to compute it. And notice, sort of as Grant pointed out, a special case when if the U3 norm is bigger than epsilon is when actually there is a quadratic with which the correlation is bigger than epsilon. And what we are trying to say is, can we find a quadratic with which the correlation is at least eta, if you know that there is some with correlation epsilon? Now, quadratics are what is called the Reed-Muller codes, the truth tables of quadratics. So what you know is your function is at distance half minus 2 epsilon from some codeword of the Reed-Muller code. And you want to find some other codeword with which the distance is at most half minus 2 eta. And this is, but the list decoding radius of the Reed-Muller code is 1/4, so we are way beyond that. And there can be exponentially many such functions. But it's still tractable because I'm only asking you to find one of them. And this can be done. Sort of, apparently, it hasn't been studied. Like, people didn't want to find one if there were exponentially many. But in this case, it's sort of interesting to find one. Okay, so I'll need one more notion, which is the notion of derivatives, before I get into Samorodnitsky's test. And so the derivative of a function f, and for the rest of the talk, we'll actually assume that f is a function which is not only bounded but Boolean. And if it's between minus 1 and 1, instead of being exactly minus 1 and 1, you can sort of randomly round the function. If it's some value t between minus 1 and 1, you can make it minus 1 with some probability and 1 with some probability. And the expectation over this process, or sort of with very high probability, you neither change the correlation of f with any quadratic nor the U3 norms. Everything works for that. But it's nicer to deal with these functions for now. This is the real question of Reed-Muller codes. We'll define the notion of derivative of function. The derivative of f in the direction y is a function of x, and it's described as f of x plus y times f of x. Okay. This is just the derivative. And suppose if f was some polynomial, then the derivative is just minus 1 to the p of x plus y plus p of x, and I can write minus instead of plus because it's everything is mod 2 in the exponent. So it's a sort of it reduces the degree of the polynomial, and in particular let's see what happens when I look at f, which is actually a quadratic phase itself. So let's suppose is a quadratic phase. It's of the form x transpose mx plus b transpose x plus c. Okay. And let's look at the derivative of f in the direction y, which sort of also builds the intuition for the way Samorodnitsky's test proceeds. So let's compute the derivative. If you sort of cancel terms which appear twice, what you get is so I'm just writing maybe y transpose x is x transpose m transpose y plus or maybe let's say times minus 1 to the b transpose y plus y transpose m y. Okay. So this term doesn't depend on x, and this is the term which depends on x. And notice that it's a function of x. And now it's obvious that it's a linear function of x. And there is only one Fourier coefficient because it's a linear function. And that Fourier coefficient is actually given by this quantity, sort of alpha, which is equal to m plus m transpose times y. Right? So I know that f y hat of m plus m transpose y is equal to 1, because this is just something that depends on y, which gives me the sign of this Fourier coefficient. And this is actually the function. So what is interesting is if I start with a quadratic phase, if I take a derivative, it has a large Fourier coefficient, which is 1 actually. And moreover, the way of picking the Fourier coefficient is very nice. I apply a linear transformation to y, and whatever I get is the alpha I should look at. And Samorodnitsky sort of reduces the problem of testing for quadratics, or sort of the test is estimating the Gowers norm, and he now wants to prove that there exists a quadratic phase. So he sort of reduces the problem of proving existence of a quadratic phase to proving that there is a good linear transformation such that this quantity is large, somewhat large, bigger than some polynomial in epsilon or some eta maybe, at least for most y. And once you get there, not for most, at least like some good fraction of y's. So once you get there, from there getting the quadratic phase is not too difficult. It's maybe some Gaussian elimination and so on. So let me just write what Samorodnitsky proves, and then we'll focus more on getting a linear transformation of this form, and then I'll describe what goes on into that. This part is okay, the derivative or how we get it. Samorodnitsky proves that suppose you could find a matrix T. So this is Samorodnitsky. And some shift. Such that the following was true, that so it's linear, it's enough to find an affine function, and then it's easy to reduce it to linear and so on, but I'll not get into that. So expectation over y f y hat square of t y plus z. Okay, so you take the derivative of f in the direction y, and you look at the t y plus z Fourier coefficient of it, or given by this, and look at the square of that. And suppose I can tell you that this is bigger than eta. Then there exists a quadratic phase such that it's bigger than eta square. So this is how it comes out in the proof. So because I will show only how to find t y plus z, but Samorodnitsky shows that it's, I mean, if you have t y plus z, then t y also works essentially, because I mean you would expect it to be linear rather than some affine thing. So the proof first finds something which is of this form, then he as sort of a two line argument it says that instead of t y you could also look at t y plus z. I just do not want to get into that argument, and hence I am writing this test form, the theorem. And then so getting from t y plus d z to a matrix of this form, which is a symmetric matrix m plus m transpose, involves some steps which are only Gaussian elimination. So those can be done very efficiently in terms of algorithms. Once you have m plus m transpose, you know the quadratic part of your function. And so now you can look at f of x times this quadratic part, which is only a linear function, or which correlates well with a linear function. And then it comes down to and it has correlation epsilon with this linear function, right? If you multiply this with f, if f had correlation epsilon with the whole quadratic phase. So and then finding a linear function which is well correlated is Goldreich-Levin. So once I'm down to this step, all I need to do is Gaussian elimination and Goldreich-Levin. And the question of getting here is what I'll address now.
So you really use Goldreich-Levin as a complete tool?
Oh, many, many more times. So the running time of the algorithm is actually dominated by order n square calls to Goldreich-Levin. And so that's basically, I mean, times a lot of horrendous factors on epsilon. But in terms of n, that's the dominating factor. Okay. So I'll describe to you how Samorodnitsky's argument proceeds. And because sort of what happens in the proofs is at a technical stage of that, I'll sort of explain to you where the proofs fit in or what goes into the proofs, but I won't give you the full ones. Okay, so the argument itself actually is in three steps to get there. And so let me just give you a sketch of those three steps and then tell you what how we change each of them to get an algorithm. Never mind. Is it okay so far? Is there any question? Okay. So the first step is instead of this linear transformation from the form ty plus z, you just find some function of y which satisfies a property like that. The Fourier coefficients are large. And the function is somewhat linear. So in particular, what he proves is if I know that the phase 1, which is if I know that the U3 norm of f is large, then I mean after manipulating the definition of U3 norm and using Holder's inequality once, you get that expectation over x and y of summation over alpha and beta f hat square, f x hat square alpha, f y hat square beta, f x plus y square alpha plus beta is greater than or equal to say epsilon to the 16. That's not sense. Now, what does this expression really mean? Let's choose a function. So, let's choose a random function phi, where I say phi of x is supposed to be, or let's say phi of y more suggestively, which is supposed to pick a large Fourier coefficient for the derivative in direction y. Let's just say it is it's equal to f y hat square alpha. Oh, it's equal to alpha with probability f y hat square alpha. Okay. Then this quantity is exactly the probability that phi of x plus phi of y equals phi of x plus y over the choice of phi and x and y. Is that? Phi is a random function. Phi is chosen, phi of y is alpha with probability f y hat square alpha. So, the probability for a fixed x y and the probability that this happens, probability over the choice of phi, that phi of x plus phi of y equals phi of x plus y, is actually just what is the value of phi of x? It's alpha with probability f hat x square alpha. What is the whatever is the value of phi of y, which is the beta with probability f hat square y beta, and then you want phi of x plus y to be alpha plus beta, and that happens with probability f of x plus y hat square alpha plus beta. So, for a fixed x y, this is the probability, and then you take the probability over x plus y, which is just the expectation of this quantity. And we know that this is bigger than epsilon to the 16, which means that if I pull out phi and I write this quantity, it is bigger than epsilon to the 16 over 2 for at least with some constant probability over the choice of phi. Okay. Now, there is a slight twist in the sense you do not only want this alpha beta and alpha beta alpha plus beta linearity relation, you also want this Fourier coefficient to be large, because in the derivative it is actually 1. So, then you actually put a condition which is of the form or sort of in here, and f x hat square phi of x f x f y hat square phi of y, and the same for x plus y, phi of x plus y. So, whatever Fourier coefficients phi predicts are all bigger, the squares of the Fourier coefficients are all bigger than gamma for some gamma to be chosen appropriately. Now, what happens is, now you want a lower bound on this quantity. So, you just look at this summation and separate out the terms which are in which at least one of the three things is smaller than gamma. So, you get whatever that is at most gamma times the rest of the sum plus gamma here times the rest of the sum plus gamma here times the rest of the sum. So, you get 3 gamma times sum of squares of some Fourier coefficients, which is at most 1 if I am adding overall. So, I get this minus 3 gamma if I want this sort of I am summing over only special alpha beta. And that means this probability, and if I choose say gamma to be epsilon to the 16 over 6 or something like that, then I get I get 4 here and 4 here. So, and let us call this condition star, just refer to this a few times. Now, it is actually easy to see how I would make this step algorithmic, which is because I am only interested in the large Fourier coefficients anyway, instead of sampling phi of y to be alpha with probability f hat y, which requires me to know all the Fourier coefficients of f y, I just do it in the following way. I just apply Goldreich-Levin on f sub y. I get all the Fourier coefficients which are bigger than gamma, and I just sample from them with probability proportional to their size. And the rest, I just don't sample. Or sort of with the remaining probability, I answer randomly. So that will essentially give me the same bound here, because I'm only sampling Fourier coefficients bigger than gamma. If you account for the error of Goldreich-Levin and so on, maybe you'll get some other coefficient in front of the gamma. So you just choose gamma a little smaller. And by little smaller, I just mean maybe 3 times smaller. That's all. But the catch is that I can't write down the whole of phi. Phi is an exponential size function. So the rest of the argument will actually require me to work with phi, and I'll make sure that I can work with only polynomial queries to this function phi. So I'll do a lazy sampling. Whenever I need the value of phi at some input y, I'll run Goldreich-Levin on f sub y. I'll compute the value of phi of y, and I'll store it in a data structure. And after the algorithm is run, I can argue that with probability at least epsilon to the 16 over 4, these samples were coming from a good phi, in which case I'll get a good quadratic function, good quadratic phase. And I can test it. If I get a quadratic phase and if it correlates well with f or not, for a given quadratic phase, it's very easy to check. It's again estimating a mean of some number. So I can test the correlation. If it's not good, I'll just run the whole thing again. It happens with probability epsilon to the 16 over 4 that I get a good quadratic phase. So after maybe 1 over epsilon to the 16 runs, or order 1 over epsilon to the 16 runs, I will get, or if I multiply that by a log 1 over delta, I will get a good quadratic phase with probability at least 1 minus delta. So this is how this part will go, in the sense of making it algorithmic. The next two parts are the ones where somewhat more issues arise. Okay, the first part is okay, the sketch of how to make it algorithmic. I mean, I haven't computed the bounds and errors. And I will only make polynomial queries to phi, and I will make the error of Goldreich-Levin polynomially small, so that I will assume that it actually correctly samples from the distribution I am looking at. Or so it doesn't have to be exactly this probability, even if it's half of this probability, I'm still okay. And I know that these numbers are bigger than gamma, so I'm allowing an additive error of gamma over 2 in the probabilities of in the coefficients of Goldreich-Levin. And I know that can be done with some small error. And I'll make the error polynomially small, I'll assume that this holds for all the queries that I make to phi if I make polynomially many queries. Okay. The second part is the application of what is called the Gowers U3U3 Samre dilemma theorem. Which is actually the most sort of involved step in terms of algorithm. I mean, there it's a black box, but so you look at this set A sub phi, which is defined as A sub phi, which is just defined as and for us, so pretty much whenever we compute phi, this is true, except for some derivative in some directions y. In some directions y, there might not be a large Fourier coefficient, we might be answering phi in some random way, in which case it will not be true. Okay. But you look at this set, and what Gowers U3U3 Samreddhi says tells you is that if this set has a lot of additive structure, so which means that if I look at A1 and A2, which are both in A sub phi, A1 and A2 are tuples of this form, such that the probability that A1 plus A2 is in A sub phi is bigger than rho, then there exists, so I'm writing it somewhat more specifically for this case. A sub phi prime, which is a subset of A sub phi. Such that the subset is large. So let's say actually say rho times 2 to the n. I mean, for this specific set, and what is rho? So I'm just calling this quantity epsilon to the 16 over 4. To be rho, not to have to write it again and again, or maybe by 8 if you want. So, but it's of this order. And that when you add this set to itself, it doesn't grow too much. So the set is reasonably large, but when you add it to itself, notice that it's a set in f sub 2 to the 2n, because but it doesn't grow much beyond size 2 to the n. Okay. This set is of size, it's set of size, it's also at most 2 to the n, because for every y there is only one phi of y, so it's a subset. This part I'll leave up there, and I'll sort of explain to you how to make it algorithmic later. And for now, I'll go to the third phase of the algorithm, which is I'll sort of explain to you the Samorodnitsky's proof, which is the application of Ruja's the Freeman-Ruja theorem, and that sort of finishes the proof. So even if you don't necessarily want to decode quadratic phases and so on, this itself is just a question of how do you apply this theorem in a way that you get a better description of this set A sub phi prime instead of just saying that there exists one. In particular, okay, we'll see what we need. The third part, which is Freeman-Ruja, is the following, which says that the span of A sub phi prime, because A sub phi prime has this property that when you add it to itself, it doesn't grow much, its span is actually small. And this is where you lose the exponential factor. So it says x, span is less than exponential in 1 over rho to some constant, where rho was giving you some bound on how it doubles, times 2 to the n, let's say. And this is the Freeman-Ruja theorem. And so this again is some subset of f2 to the 2n, because it's defined in there. Let's assume that when I look at its projection onto the first n coordinates, it's a full rank, the subspace, which means I get all possible coordinate values there. So and let v1 to vk be a basis for this. Okay. Oh no, for the span. Okay. For the entire span, it's a, so these are set of vectors in 2n dimensions. Now, because it's a basis, I should say this exposition is from Samorodnitsky. So this proof I'm giving you is from Samorodnitsky and also from an exposition by Viola. Kind of very nice if you want to read these proofs. So now, if I have y and phi of y, which is inside A sub phi prime, then I know that I can write it as a linear combination of these guys. So some linear combination. So I have the vector v1 to vk. So this, there are 2n rows here and there are k columns times some vector w. Okay. And by Gaussian elimination, instead of applying invertible transformation, I can change this matrix into the following form. I can get identity here because I assumed that it was full rank on the first n coordinates. And because it's large enough, I can add few vectors and make it full rank on the first n coordinates. There is 0 here, there is some t here and some matrix u here. I don't know what they are. And this is true for every y and phi of y. So in particular, the first n coordinates of w must be y itself because I am applying the identity. And the rest is some something else, z, right? And so I get here. I don't know how to get 0.
Because you can subtract all the rows and change the coordinates to reflect. I don't think you want to subtract rows.
But then you mess up y.
Then this guy goes away, right? I don't know what y phi of y is. Right. So here I know that for these guys, phi of y equals t y plus u sub z. Or u times z. Where u is some arbitrary matrix and I don't know what it is. But again, so now let's just see what is the number of coordinates in z. So y is n dimensional. The number of rows in z or in w is basically n plus log of this number, which is the dimension of this span or the number k. So the number of rows in z is just order 1 over rho to the c. I can pick a random z, z naught, and then with probability which is exponentially small n minus 1 over rho to the c. So I have a linear transformation, an affine transformation, which agrees with phi of y inside a phi prime, at least with probability this much. This is where the exponential loss happens. So now I just wanted to compute this quantity, if you remember, which was just summation over expectation over y f y hat square of t y plus let's call this u naught. Now this is when I am inside a phi prime. So when I am inside a phi prime, then it agrees with phi of y. I am inside a sub phi prime with probability at least rho, right? So as I go over the entire span of these guys in the span, they are of this form, t of y plus u of z for some z, right? So in particular, if I go over all z's, at least this many of them must have one single z because there are not too many choices for z. Because the dimension of, so this is equal to k, the number of coordinates in y plus number of coordinates in z, which is the dimension of this span, right? And the dimension of this span cannot be too large, it's just n plus, at most n plus 1 over rho to the c. Okay. So I get some fixed z naught for which this is equal to this with probability at least this much. So I get I'm inside A sub phi prime with at least this probability. And when I'm inside A sub phi prime, f hat y square phi of y with which I'm agreeing is at least gamma, where gamma was order rho again. So I get this as my eta. And that sort of finishes Samorodnitsky's proof. And now I need to give you a sketch of what the algorithm does. Okay, so as I said, I won't prove those. So here, to make this part algorithmic, you need to actually go into the proof of this guy, of this theorem. And one good proof to look at is one by Sudakov, Samredi, and Wu. So there is a proof by Sudakov, Samredi, and Wu from 2005, which essentially defines a graph on the set of vertices which are of the form y phi of y. And the edge, there is an edge between x phi of x and y phi of y. If phi of x plus phi of y is equal to phi of x plus y and all the Fourier coefficients are large, some condition which I had called star, but I unfortunately erased. So which is sort of linearity plus largeness. So, and then the what the proof does is that this set A sub phi prime is actually the neighborhood of some random vertex in this graph minus some bad set. So it looks at the neighborhood and picks up some good set in there. And to be able to implement that proof, so what I need to do is not really know the description of the entire set A sub phi prime, but I just need to know the span of it. And actually, as I'll show later, even if I know some large fraction of the span, I'm good. So what you really need to be able to do is to sample from A sub phi prime very well. To be able to sample, I just need to be able to sort of, be able to test edges in this graph, at least, to be able to sample from some modified neighborhood with some conditions. Yeah, this graph is on vertices of this form, x sub x comma phi of x. This is the vertex set. The vertex set.
So phi is not fixed.
So for this part of the argument, assume that phi is fixed. But this argument will only make polynomial queries to that fixed phi. And so then we'll combine it with the first part. For now, let's think that phi is completely sampled and phi is fixed.
So A phi is the neighborhood of phi.
A phi is. Fe is a set defined by phi. It's not in terms of the graph.
So what is that set in the graph?
Oh, that set in the graph, it's the description is fairly complicated and I don't want to define it to you. I just want to say that there is a graph and it's some neighborhood in the graph. I don't want to give you the precise details of what it looks like. I mean, I can give you those after the talk, but slightly long description.
That's the set that's going to be A prime sub phi?
This set is what will come out as A prime sub phi, which will be, I look at a neighborhood of some vertex inside this graph and choose a suitable subset of that neighborhood.
And this will be a constant probability thing, not a high probability.
This will be a constant probability thing, but again, sort of, I'll run through this argument, and if the end is that I don't get good correlation, I'll run the whole thing again. So it will be the same thing as what happened with the sampling of phi. Okay. And now, so just I want to test, suppose that if there is an edge in this graph or not. So, to test linearity, if I know phi, suppose, if I have sampled phi very well, then testing linearity is not a problem because phi of x is easy to check. The problem is largeness because I cannot calculate the Fourier coefficients exactly, only so largeness means that I want the Fourier coefficient square to be bigger than some gamma. So I can give you an edge test, I can give you an algorithm. If it outputs 1, implies that sort of the vertices are in some graph in which the largeness is at least gamma minus gamma prime for some small gamma prime. because I can only approximately test the Fourier coefficients. And if it's 0 implies that they are not in some other graph. And this is what actually complicates the proof, because in there you define the neighborhood, then you remove some bad pairs in the neighborhood and you do all those things. The problem is, because of these bounds, we can only talk of some properties in terms of this graph and some properties in terms of this graph. So we have to work with the mixture of these two graphs all the time. What you can get is an algorithm which I'll call BSG test, which takes inputs some parameters and a vertex, and it's supposed to be a tester if a certain vertex lies in this set or not, where the set is chosen by the parameters, is defined by the parameters. And I can actually give you two sets, A sub phi 1, which is contained in A sub phi 2, which is contained in A sub phi, such that if the test outputs 1, implies I am in the larger, I am definitely in the larger set. And if it outputs 0, then I am not in the smaller set. Moreover, with some positive probability over the choice of the parameters, with probability some rho square over parameters, the smaller set is large, and the larger set has small doubling. So I get the same conclusion sort of as in Balog-Gower-Samredi, but for these two different sets, and I sandwich the outputs on which this test outputs 1 between these two. This is actually the most technical part of the proof, proving this version working with this graph. Once you have them, this part is not so bad. What you do is you sample on which the test outputs 1. So on a random element, the test outputs 1 with some constant probability, because it's at least from this. So with order n square samples, you can get order n square elements on which the test outputs 1. And then you look at the span of those elements. There is a Chernoff bound, so the span is some subspace. You want to say that this at least, so what you want to be able to say about the span are two things. One is that its dimension is not too large, which gives you a bound on this and hence a bound on this term. And the second is that it at least contains a good number of elements from this A sub phi prime. This span, which is now sampled, and so you need to be slightly more careful. So it contains a good number of elements from A sub phi prime. This part is true because this span lives inside the span of the larger set, because all the sampled elements lie also in the larger sets. If they live, so this also happens with some error probability, and you make it very small again. So they all lie in the larger set. You can get a bound on the span of the larger set again by Ruja's theorem. And so you get that this term is of the same order. And you want to say that a lot of elements from A sub phi prime are or a lot of elements of this form, essentially, y sub comma y phi of y, lie inside the span of the sampled elements. So to do that, you just need to say that fix a subspace, which I think my span is. What is the chance that from this, if I sample t elements from this subspace, they all cover only less than half of this set A sub phi prime, or let's say A sub of this guy. So I want to say that with good probability, my span will cover at least half of this set, which then I'm done because this set has all elements of the form y phi of y. And what is the probability if I look at t samples? What is the probability that doesn't cover enough elements from the set? It's and what I'm sampling from is a space larger than this, at least is larger than this set. Right? So every element has a probability half of being in being from some subset of A sub phi, which is very small. And I take so if the span, so I'll just sum over spans of sort of S is the span, and then this is the probability that I sample when I sample random elements from S, I only get things which are within a half subset of A sub phi. And then I take a union bound over all subspaces again, which requires me order n square samples, and that sort of finishes the proof. Stop here.